Hello and welcome to today's lecture on secured communication. This is the second lecture on this topic. In the last lecture, we have considered the topic various issues on cryptography, which has been found to be the panacea to the problem of secured communication. And in this lecture, we shall cover various topics essentially which are applications of cryptography, and we shall see how cryptography can be used to achieve secured communication, particularly the four different types of services required in secured communication. And here is the outline of today's talk. First, I shall give a brief introduction. Then, I shall discuss about the applications of cryptography, as I mentioned. Particularly, this will lead to privacy, integrity, authentication, and non-repudiation. These are the four services to be provided for secured communication. Then, apart from message privacy, message integrity, message authentication, and non-repudiation, it is necessary to provide user authentication, which is important in the context of key management. Then we shall discuss how key management can be done by using suitable techniques. Then we shall consider a application layer protocol, pretty good privacy, PGP, which can be used for secured communication of emails. And I shall conclude my lecture after discussing virtual private network, which is essentially a network used for secured communication. And on completion of this lecture, the students will be able to state various services needed for secured communication. They will be able to explain how the four services such as privacy, authentication, integrity, and non-repudiation are achieved using cryptography. They will be able to state how user authentication is performed. They will be able to explain how PGP protocol, that pretty good privacy protocol, works, and also they will be able to explain how virtual private network works. So, as I mentioned in the last lecture, these are the four important services required for secured communication. The first one is privacy, second one is authentication, third one is integrity, fourth one is non-repudiation. By privacy, we mean a person, say Sita, as I mentioned in cryptography, we normally use three characters, the sender, receiver, and the person in the middle. Sender here, we have used the character Sita, the receiver is Ram, and the person in the middle, who is essentially the intruder or eavesdropper, who is trying to impersonate, is Ravan. So, with this background, privacy, we mean a person, say Sita, should be able to send a message to another person, say Ram, privately. By privately, we mean even if the message is received by other than Ram, then it will not be intelligible to him or her. So it should be intelligible only to Ram, but not by anybody else. So that is the basic reason for privacy. Second is authentication. After the message is received by Ram, he should be sure that the message has been sent by nobody else but by Sita. That means the authentication of the sender is verified, has to be authenticated. Then the integrity. Ram should be sure that the message has not been tampered on transit. So, when the message is passing through a network, unreliable network, it may be tampered by the intruder, say Ravan. So, he will try to modify it to his advantage and if necessary corrupt it, and that should be clear to Ram. Ram should be able to identify if a message is tampered on transit. Finally, is the non-repudiation. Ram should be able to prove at a later stage that the message was indeed received from Sita. So, there may be a situation when Sita may say at a later stage, that a particular message was not sent by her to Ram. So Ram should be able to prove that it was indeed sent by Sita. So that is the requirement, service requirement from, in the context of non-repudiation. First, we shall focus on privacy. How privacy can be achieved by using cryptography? It can be achieved by cryptography by using shared key or symmetric key approach. Here, what can be done? Sita can convert the plain text into ciphered text by encrypting it with the help of a shared key. And so, encrypted message is now sent through the medium which is not safe. So, in the middle, the Ravan may try to get access of it, but it will not be intelligible, it will be unintelligible to Ravan. So, after it reaches Ram, he should be able to decrypt it with the help of the same shared key and get back the message. So, the privacy is satisfied here, because even if Ravan gets the message, it will not be understandable to him. So, here the basic issue is that key is shared between Ram and Sita, and particularly in shared key approach, we require a very large number of keys, and that is one important problem, and how it can be resolved we shall discuss later. Then comes the privacy by using public key cryptography. Here what is being done? Sita performs encryption, so that means converts the plain text into ciphered text with the help of the public key of Ram. So the public key of Ram is used to do the encryption, and the encrypted message traverses through the medium, unreliable medium, and as it reaches Ram, then decryption can be done with the help of the private key of Ram. So Ram can do the decryption by using his private key to get back the plain text from the ciphered text. So this is how the privacy of the message is preserved by this technique. So in this case, the problem is, you see, the Sita is using the public key of Ram. So it is necessary to verify that the public key indeed belongs to Ram, not by some imposter. So if an imposter sends a public key to Sita, and if she uses that public key for sending through the medium, then the purpose will be lost. So this has to be verified in the context of public key cryptography, when you use public key cryptography. So you have seen how privacy can be maintained by using shared key cryptography and by public key cryptography. Let us now focus on the other three aspects or services required, that is authentication, integrity, and non-repudiation. And these three services can be achieved by using a technique known as digital signature. What is digital signature? Let us try to understand. The idea of digital signature is very similar to signing a document. Normally, whenever we send a document, and particularly if it is legal document or something else, on each page signature is given. So that signature actually authenticates the document. And somewhat similar technique is used here. However, here the signature, whereby signature we mean some kind of encryption is being done. How it is done is explained here by using the public key cryptography. Here, Sita does the encryption by using the private key of Sita. So, private key of Sita is being used here for doing the encryption of the plain text, and the ciphered text passes through the network, and as it reaches the receiver Ram, he does the decryption by using the public key of Sita. So here you see the public key of Sita is used to do the decryption, and private key of Sita is being used to do the encryption. So by this process, Ram is able to achieve all the three services required. For example, authentication is done, because here Ram is doing the decryption by using the public key of Sita. That means if it was not received from Sita, if it was not received from Sita, then obviously the encryption decryption would not have been possible by using the public key of Sita. So it does authentication, and integrity is also verified, because the entire message was encrypted, and after decryption it is possible to regenerate the plain text. So since it is possible to regenerate the plain text, it is, the integrity is maintained. That means if the message was tampered on transit, then it is not possible to get back the plain text after decryption. So the integrity is also achieved by using this approach. Finally comes the question of non-repudiation. Here, since the decryption has been done by using the public key of Sita, later on if somebody asks Ram, can you prove that the message that you received was indeed received from Sita, what he can do? He can do the that plain text that was generated can be encrypted again by the public key of private key of Sita, and then decrypted by using the public key of Sita to get back the same plain text. So that verifies, that proves that the message was indeed received from Sita, because it was possible to do the decryption by the public key of Sita. So all the three aspects are satisfied by using this digital signature technique. However, this digital signature can be done by using two approaches. First one is signing the entire document, and second one is signing the digest. So if signing the entire document is done, that is possibly better, but it is not very efficient, because the message can contain can be very large, and so encryption will take a lot of time, but particularly by using the public key cryptography. As you know, in public key cryptography, the size of the key is quite large, more than 256 bits, and as a consequence, the encryption takes very long time. So if it is done on the entire message, it will take very long time, so it is not very efficient. That is why another approach can be done, which is known as digital signature, which is essentially a miniature version of the original message. So a miniature version of the original message is used for the purpose of for the purpose of this authentication, integrity and non-repudiation verification. However, this digital signature will not be able to provide privacy, as we shall see. Now let us see, what do we really mean by this message digest, and how it can be done? It can be done, that means the message digest can be done by using a technique known as hashing. What the hashing does, suppose this is the message. So message is applied to a hashing function and to generate a digest. This is your digest. What it effectively does, it converts a variable length message, converts it into a fixed length, as it is written here, fixed length digest. So it is somewhat similar to generating CRC or checksum. We have seen that for the purpose of error detection, checksum or cyclic redundancy codes are used. And those checksum and cyclic redundancy codes are either 16 bit or 32 bit long, and those are generated from a long message. So here also, in a somewhat similar technique, a fixed length digest is created from the variable length message. And some standard techniques have been developed to perform hashing, and most common hashing functions are MD5, Message Digest 5 approach, which uses 120 bit or 128-bit digest. That means a fixed-length 120-bit digest is generated by using this approach, Message Digest 5, which is very popular and widely used. There is another approach, Secured Hash Algorithm 1, SHA-1, which uses 160-bit digest. And obviously, SHA-1 is much more secure than the MD5 because it uses 160-bit instead of 120-bit. However, SHA-1 is less popular than MD5. Now, you must understand two very important properties of this hashing operation. First of all, it is one-to-one. What do you really mean by one-to-one? For each message, the digest has to be unique. That means the digest that is created has to be unique for a given message, and that requirement is satisfied if the digest is about 128-bit. So if it is chosen about 128-bit, then that condition is satisfied, and or 128-bit or more than 128-bit. And another condition that has to be said that is satisfied is it is one way. That means from the message, you can generate the digest, but you cannot really generate the message from the digest. That means the reverse process is not possible. So a message cannot be generated from the digest, and that's why it is one way. So these two properties are to be satisfied for the message digest to be successful. Let us see how the signing is done on the digest. So signing the digest is performed. So here again we are using the private key, public key approach to do the signing on the digest. Here Sita is generating a message. Then some hashing operation is performed, maybe MD5. MD5 is version 5 is used to do the hashing to generate, say, 120-bit digest. This 128-bit digest is encrypted by using Sita's private key. And then that signed digest is sent along with the message to RAM. So the RAM not only the message is being sent, but the signed digest is also sent. So here you see the signed digest is encrypted version of the digest. On the other hand, the message is not encrypted. As a result, it does not give you the privacy. So privacy is not provided by this approach. However, it provides the other three functions that I have mentioned, that authentication, integrity, and non-repudiation. Now let us see what is done at the other end. At the other end, RAM receives the message along with the signed digest. Then the signed digest is decrypted by using Sita's public key. Since the encryption was done by using Sita's private key, the decryption can be done by using Sita's public key. So after doing the decryption, the digest is created. Now, the message is now received in its original form, in plain text form. This plain text form message again is used to generate the digest by using the hashing operation. That is, again, the MT5 is used to generate the hashing, and the digest is created. If these two digests are same, they are compared. If they are same, then the authentication, integrity, and non-repudiation is satisfied. So digest created using the received message is compared with the decrypted digest. So in this way, the digest message digest is used to perform the three operations I have mentioned. Now, apart from this message authentication, checking authentication of the integrity of the message, it is necessary to do user authentication, and this is related to essentially key management. And it is how the user authentication can be done is explained here. this can be done in various ways. The first approach is based on symmetric key cryptography. Here, what is being done? Sita sends her identity and password. So, identity and password is being sent in encrypted form by using that shared key KSR. KSR is essentially the shared key between Sita and Ram. SR stands for Sita and Ram. So, the shared key is being used to do the encryption, where the identity of Sita along with password is sent to Ram. Then Ram now knows that it is the message is indeed coming from Sita. So, the user authentication is being performed, and then the message communication takes place. Sita can send message by using the encryption based on that shared key KSR. So, in this way message communication can go on. However, here this particular approach has some problem. First problem is the intruder can cause damage without accessing it. That means, whenever this particular message is going through the network, then the intruder or Ravan can get hold of it, can modify it and send it. So, it can cause damage without accessing it. So, in such a case, Ram will not be able to verify, will not be able to authenticate Sita. Secondly, the intruder what can do, instead of this particular message can be replayed, can be generated twice. Suppose Sita is sending a message to a banker to make some payment. Now, one message is sent to pay, let's assume 10,000 rupees. Another message can be replayed, can be resent by the impostor or intruder, and as a consequence, two payments are being made, although Sita has sent only one message for making the payment. So, the banker is making two payments instead of one payment, because the same message was resent by the intruder twice, and this is known as replay attack. So, you have to overcome this replay attack, and how it can be done is explained later. This problem can be overcome by using a approach known as N1s. A random number is used only once to do the authentication. What is being done? After Sita sends her identity, the Ram receives that identity, then the Ram sends a no ones, that means one random Ram number RR, that means it has been generated by Ram, a random number which is being sent to Sita. So, as a challenge it is being sent to Sita, and after Sita receives it, she does encryption, she responds by sending the encrypted form of this random number RR, and after receiving that, Ram is happy, because now he is confident that the message is indeed coming from Sita, and this particular approach is known as challenge response protocol. So, by using this challenge response protocol, the above problem is verified, because after a session is created, that resending of message cannot be done twice. However, in this particular situation, Ram is able to authenticate the user Sita, but Sita is not able to authenticate Ram. So, to do that, one can use two-way authentication. So, in this particular case, Sita sends her identity to Ram, Ram sends the challenge by sending RR, which is that random number to Sita. Sita sends the encrypted version of RR to Ram. Ram now is now confident that the message is coming from Sita. Then Ram also sends one message. Ram also sends one here. Sita also sends that another random number RS to challenge Ram, and after receiving that RS, Ram responds with the encrypted version of RS by using the symmetric key which is being shared by both of them. Then they can communicate under the cover of KSR. So in this way, verification is done, two-way verification is done. However, this particular approach requires more number of communications of messages, and this can be reduced as it is shown in this approach. Here, instead of 5 messages, only 3 messages can suffice. That's why it is a shortened two-way authentication approach. What is being done here? Sita not only sends her identity, but also that random number in a single message to Ram. Ram in turn does the encryption of that random number and sends the encrypted version along with another random number generated by Ram n once, and that is being sent to Sita. Now Sita in turn does the encryption by using that that shared key of RR and sends it to Ram. So in this way, by sending 3 messages, the authentication, the two-party authentication is being performed. So this is how user authentication can be done by using the symmetric key cryptography. The user authentication can also be done by using public key cryptography in this manner, as it is explained here. Here, again, Sita sends a message by sending her identity and the random number RS, and that is being encrypted by using the public key of Sita. So, public key of Ram. So, it is encryption is done by using the public key of Ram. It is known to Sita. Now, after receiving that, Ram responds with the encrypted version of the RS, RR, and KS. KS is the key generated for that session. So, a new session key is being generated, and that is being sent in encrypted form, and which is encrypted by using ES, that is the public key of Sita, which is known to Ram. So, after receiving that, Sita knows that it has been done by Ram, and Sita does the decryption by using her private key and get back RS, RR, and KS. Then she sends RR in an encrypted form by using the session key KS to Ram. So in this way, by using public key cryptography, the user authentication can be done. Now, as I mentioned in the last class, the particularly the symmetric key cryptography is not very efficient because of large number of keys to be generated when the number of users is large. As I mentioned, if there is 1 million people who are interested in communication, then you will require 500 billion keys that can be that has to be generated, and that is very difficult to do. And that's why a simpler and efficient technique has to be used for the purpose of key management, and that can be done by one-time session key for two parties. And that means per session a key generated only for that session, and that is being used by both the parties for that session. And again, in the next session, another new key is generated, and that can be done by using a protocol known as Diffie-Hellman key exchange protocol. So this is used to establish a shared secret key per session basis. The prerequisite is, in the beginning, both the parties should know two large numbers N and G. So these two numbers have some properties. First of all, N is a large prime number such that n minus 1 by 2 is also a prime number, and g is also a prime number. As an example, for simplicity, let's assume g is equal to 7 and n is equal to 23. In practice, the numbers are much larger. To explain the approach, I have taken smaller numbers. Now, after n and g are known to both the parties, Sita chooses a large random number x to calculate R1. R1 is equal to g to the power x mod n. Let's assume x is equal to 3. So he creates R1 is equal to g to the power x mod n. That means 7 to the power is R1 is equal to 7 to the power 3 mod n is 23, and that is equal to 21. So this 21 is sent to Ram. Now, after receiving this number, the Ram can generate the key by using this approach k is equal to. After receiving this, the Ram generates it the key by using this 21 to the power 6. 6 is here, y is equal to 6. That has been used by that number has been used by Ram to the power 6 mod 23, and that is equal to 18. So 18 is the key. Now, so this is how the key is generated at the Ram's end, which can be used. That means 18 can be used as the shared key. Now let's see what Ram does. Ram calculates R2 is equal to g to the power y mod n. So what is g to the power y mod n? That is equal to g is equal to 7, 7 to the power, and y is equal to 6, and mod 23. And that is equal to 4. 4 is being sent by Ram to Sita. And after receiving 4, what Sita does, she generates the key is equal to 4 to the power 3. That means g to the power y mod g to the power y, I mean g to the power x. So Sita does the g to the power x, R2 to the power x mod 23, and again he gets 18. So you see, both the parties have generated, got the secret key, shared secret key, and so this is essentially working based on number theory. So I have illustrated with small numbers, but when large numbers are used, it is quite safe, but it serves the purpose of generating a shared secret key per session basis. So this is how key management can be done. So apart from this approach, there are other approaches. Another important approach, which is based on what is known as key distribution center, KDC. So key distribution center is essentially a trusted third party which maintains a database of the keys, and it is used, the key distribution center maintains the keys and delivers the keys to different parties. So assigns a symmetric key to both the parties. That is the role of the trusted third party KDC. However, this approach is not foolproof, and a popular authentication protocol has been developed, which is known as Kerberos, which uses the concept of key distribution center. But in addition to key distribution center, it does more, and it actually uses a authentication server AS and a ticket granting server TGS apart from the real data server. So it generates two servers. One of them is authentication server, second one is ticket granting server, and third one is real data server. Essentially this can be Ram's server, and by using these three servers the authentication is being done. Let's see how it is being done with the help of this particular diagram. So here, as you can see, Sita is sending a message. Before the messages are sent, a six-way protocol is being performed. Sita sends her name to the authentication server AS, and after receiving that identity of Sita, the authentication server generates a session key, that is KAC, and a TGS token to be used by Sita. So using that token, I mean, after receiving this, Sita will simply type her password to get the key, the session key. And using that session key, she will do the encryption of a timestamp and also inform the ticket granting server with whom she wants to communicate, that is Ram, and also she will send the token, that this token in encrypted form, which is the shared key between Sita and the ticket granting server. So that is KTG. So this is being sent to the ticket granting server. Since it is being encrypted by using the shared key between the ticket granting server and Sita, it will accept this request and it will generate two tickets. TGS response will be creating a session key for Sita to use with Ram. So you can see session KAC Ram, comma KSR, that is being generated, and KSR KR Sita, comma SR. So these two tickets are being generated, where you can see this KSR is the session key to be used by Sita for communication with Ram. So these are being sent to Sita, and after receiving this, Sita sends a message to Ram. Along with not only she sends the session key. So this is the session key to some. The ticket is encrypted by using session key, and also the timestamp. And after receiving this, Ram will respond with the will do the encryption by using KSR, that is the shared key, session key, shared session key to be used by both of them for communication by incrementing the timestamp by one. And after this is performed, then both Sita and Ram not only have authenticated their identity, but also they have got a key, shared key to be used by both of them, this KSR. And with the under the cover of KSR, under the cover of this case, this shared symmetric key, both of them will exchange messages. This is how Kerberos work, and this is very popular nowadays. Now, the security measures can be implemented by using the cryptography technique I have discussed at different layers, particularly in network layer, transport layer, and application layer. Implementing in network layer and transport layer is very difficult because there are many protocols. For each of them, you have to develop the suitable protocol for the purpose of security. So it has been found that the implementing the protocol for the application layer is the most efficient and simple, and that is the reason why I shall consider a protocol, application layer protocol, which has been used for sending emails in secured form. It was developed, invented by Phil Zimmerman, and it provides all aspects of security, that means all the four aspects that I mentioned in sending an email message. Let's see how it works. Sita is sending an email. First, the hashing is done by using the popular approaches, maybe HD5 approach. And after the hashing, the digest is created. The digest is encrypted by using Sita's private key. And that digest in encrypted form is sent along with this email, and again the entire thing is encrypted by using one time secret key that is generated. And not only it is encrypted, this one time secret key is also encrypted by using Ram's public key, and all the three are now sent. That means the secret key in encrypted form, then message and digest in encrypted form, and all the three are being sent to Ram at the other end. And after receiving the encrypted secret key and message plus digest, the decryption is done in this manner. RAM performs the decryption, as you can see here. The secret key is decrypted by using RAM's private key, because it was encrypted by using RAM's private key, public key. Since it was encrypted by using RAM's private key, it is decrypted by using RAM's private key. So the one-time secret key is now generated, and this message plus digest, which was created by, which was encrypted by using one-time secret key, so that is your symmetric key, and that is being used now for decryption to get back the message, the digest along with the email. Now the message digest was in encrypted form by using Sita's private key. Now it is decrypted by using Sita's public key to get back the digest. And email is also passed through a hashing function, and digest is created, and both the digest are compared to check whether they are same or not. If they are same, that means all the three functions are satisfied. That means privacy, authentication, integrity and non-repudiation are satisfied. That means message is being communicated in secured form. And however, if it does not match, then it does not. Then there is some problem. The email message has been modified or corrupted. Now we shall discuss an approach by which a secured communication network or secured link can be created, and that is known as virtual private network, and that is very popular. And without this, our discussion on secured communication cannot be complete. One possible approach for realizing private network for communication communication of intra organization messages is to connect various sites by using leased line. So if the organization is located in a single building or in a single campus, then there is no problem. A LAN can be, local area network can be created, and they can communicate with each other. But in practice, that is not so, particularly organizations like National Insurance Company, then your banks, State Bank of India and other organizations have their offices throughout the country, may have thousands of offices, and they are in each place, they have got a local area network. Now they are connected with the help of leased line for communication of their private messages. So only two sites are shown here, site A and site B, but in practice there can be thousands of sites. And in this case, the intra-organization messages can be communicated through this, private wide area network created with the help of these leased lines. This particular approach is simple, but it also ensures privacy. And the advantage is here, one can use private IP addresses, because the IP addresses used in router R1 and R2 need not be a global IP. So there is no need to take permission from the global organization. So the organization itself can create their own IPs and use it in under this approach. But it has limited applicability, because these organizations, as I mentioned, banks, insurance companies, they have to serve many people. And to do that, there must be some global communication. They have to communicate through internet. So the second approach can be used by using hybrid network. So in this case, what is being done? The intra-organization communications are communicated with the help of leased line, through using router R1 and R2. On the other hand, the global communication, global internet communications are being performed through the internet by using another set of routers, R3 and R4. So separate path is there for communication of the global messages. So this is hybrid because there is private network and public network, both are being used. But the main problem in this case, and as well as the previous case, where private network is private wide area network is created by using lease lines, satellite links, and various other communication things. This is very costly. So these networks are very costly. Private wide area networks are very expensive. To overcome that, a technique known as virtual private network can be used. So in virtual private network is used for both private and public communications. Not only private message or data, but public communications is also performed by using the internet. So a global internet is used both for private and public communications. You may be asking how you are achieving security in this particular case. So in this particular case, you are using route a pair of routers R1 and R2 between two sites, and in fact all the sites are now connected to this global internet. So the another site is also connected to this internet, another site is also connected to this internet. So there is no need to deploy a public wide area network, because this internet is now available throughout the world, and so each organization has to link it to the internet. However, question arises how the security can be achieved. That can be done by using the concept of virtual private network or VPN. VPN uses IPsec, that's a protocol in the network layer known as Internet Protocol Security in the tunnel mode, and it uses two sets of addressing. As you can see here, this is site 1, this is site 2, and they are connected by using routers. So apart from the IP header and the packet that is being used by this station 150 to send the message to station 250, when it is being sent by R1, it adds another two more headers. First one is IPsec header, and in front of that a new IP header that is being used for communication between R1 and R2 through the internet that is being used, and this part is now is used as some kind of as payload. So this IP address is not being used, it is sent as payload using these four components of four fields of this message. So here it is given in more details, and particularly there are two protocols, and the second one is known as encapsulating security protocol, or ESP. And ESP they has got, as you can see, provides you source authentication, integrity, and privacy. So this is very useful because it provides all the three functionalities or services required. And here is the frame format. Here you can see it adds a ESP header and a ESP trailer, and this is the remaining payload where the you have, as I have already shown to you, this part, IP header and rest of the packet is now being sent as payload, and a new IP header is generated which is being used. And this ESP header has got two important components: security parameter indexed and sequence number. And ESP trailer has got padding to provide pad length and next header. I'm not going into the detailed explanation of this, but by using this, one can a connection oriented service is created, and here the authentication data, that means some kind of digest, is created which is being sent along with the in the packet, and this is communicated through the internet. So you can see here the packet is in the tunnel mode. The message along with the original IP address is sent as payload, and additional fields are used to achieve this authentication, integrity, and privacy by using the in the virtual private network. It is virtual because you are not really creating a private network, but you are achieving the benefits of private network. That's why it is virtual private network. That means by using the public network, you are creating a virtual private network for secured communication. Now, it is time to give you the answer to the questions of lecture number 37. First question was, what do you mean by encryption and decryption? As we have already discussed on many occasions, encryption transforms a message, that is plain text, into a form called ciphertext, which is unintelligible to an unauthorized person. But the authorized person can get back the plain text by doing decryption. So on the other hand, decryption transforms an unintelligible message into a meaningful information by an authorized person by doing the decryption. Second question was, what are the two approaches of encryption decryption technique? There are basically two approaches as follows. First one is known as one key technique, which is also known as symmetric key encryption technique. In this case, the same key is being used for encryption as well as decryption. And the second approach is known as public key approach, which is also known as asymmetric key encryption. In this case, the transmitting end key is known as public key, whereas the receiving end key is known as secret key or private key. So we have made use of these two approaches in these lectures, as you have seen. Now the third question was, for n number of users, how many keys are needed if we use private and public key cryptography? As we have seen, for private key cryptography or symmetric key cryptography, we require n into n minus 1 by 2 keys. Why? For example, suppose there are 4 nodes, then you will require this node 1 will require how many keys? So you will require at least 3 keys, and then it will require, that means 3 keys are required for communication by node A, then B will require for communication with B, C and D, B will require additional 2 keys for communication, and D will require another more. So in this way, the number of edges are essentially the number of keys required. So in case of 4, it is 4 by 3 into 2, that is your 6. As you can see, there are 6 edges. So in this way, total number of keys is quite large, n into n minus 1 by 2. On the other hand, in case of public key cryptography or asymmetric key, you require only 2n keys. The reason is each user will require one private key and another key for the rest of the world, for all the other users. So in this way, the total number of keys required is 2n. Fourth question was, how triple DS enhances performance compared to the original DS? One common complaint against this DES was that it uses a very small key. We have seen the key size was 56 bit, and obviously with 56 bit key, it is not possible to achieve very good security. So how to improve the security at the same time fully, I mean, not discarding the DES, and that means by making use DES at the same time to make it more secure, this triple DES was developed. And this effectively increases the key length. What is being done? Two keys are used to do encryption, followed by decryption, followed by encryption. So, and by doing that, the size of the key effectively is 56 plus 56, that is 112 bit, and 112 bit is considered to be quite reasonable, can give quite reasonable secrecy or security. And that's why this triple DS was invented, and it is quite popular nowadays. Last question was, explain how RSA works. The steps for RSA is as follows. It chooses two large prime numbers P and Q, typically around 256 bits. It computes N is equal to P into Q and Z is equal to P minus 1 and Q into Q minus 1. It chooses a number D, which is relatively prime to Z, that is P minus 1 into Q minus 1. And it then finds E and E such that E into D mod P minus 1 into Q minus 1 is equal to 1. Then for encryption, it is P to the power E mod N is used, and for decryption to get back the plain text, C to the power D mod N is used. So this is how RSA works, as we have explained in the last lecture. Now it is time to give you references to the various books that I have used in this lecture. So far as textbooks are concerned, the main textbook that I have used is Data Communications and Networking by Behrouz A. Farozan. And apart from this, I have used two more books. On the left side, the book by William Stallings. The name of the book is Data and Computer Communications, published by Prentice Hall of India. The third book is Computer Networks by Andrew S. Tannenbaum. Again, it is published by Prentice Hall of India. Apart from these textbooks, I have used several reference books. For example, for TCP, when we shall discuss internet working, this book is very useful, TCP/IP by Douglas E. Comer. Then for wireless communication, there were some lectures on wireless communications. I have used this Wireless Communication Principles and Practice by Theodore S. Rappaport, and this is actually published by Pearson. And then you have got a book on satellite communication, which is published by Wiley, and two more reference books which has been used when I discussed data compression. This book is by David Solomon, and on network security, the book is by Charlie Kaufman and two more authors. So these are the reference books I have used in giving my lectures. So with this, we have come to the end of not only today's lecture, but end of the 40-hour lecture series on data communications. Thank you.